Hello, True Desires. Today's video is book review of Lives of the 12 Caesars by Gaius Tranquillius Seutonius, otherwise known as Seutonius. I don't know if I'll do my best on this video, but it's like 8:15 p.m. and I'm tired, dude. So if I yawn a lot, then please excuse me. Whoa, heck oh yeah. Yeah, dude, this is a really, and I'm also a little bit buzzed because my mom took me out to dinner and I had a couple beers. Yeah, dude, Seutonius, man, Lives of the 12 Caesars. It's a really long book. I don't know how long it is. Maybe I'll include how long it is in the description section, but it's a really, really long book. And it's a really, really good history book. It would be a good book to read, like, for a woman. I think women aren't really all that into history because if you read history books, and I don't know if you know this, but if you read a lot of history books, most of it, like the vast majority of it, is like details of battles. And women aren't really into battles. You know, it's like tactics and all that kind of shit. And it can get tedious. But Seutonius doesn't deal with any of that stuff, dude. Seutonius deals with stuff that I wish, that you wish, like most historical writers would deal with. You know, like I read Julius Caesar's book, The Gallic Wars, you know, and most of that book was you know, battles and strategy and this and that. But you know, I'm thinking, oh man, well, how couldn't Julius Caesar just describe like personalities of people and what they look like? Well, Seutonius does that. That's all about Seutonius. He describes exactly how people looked, exactly what their personalities were, you know, he lists specific things that they said, and it's just the perfect description of the history. So yeah, I highly recommend it. If you're gonna read a book about history, that's the one you want to do. And it's also of the most interesting period of history, in my opinion, that ever it was, and the most interesting area of the world that ever was. So, you know, I mean, as far as I'm concerned right now, that's the best history book. It's an amazing history book. It covers a time frame from about, I don't know, 100 BC to about, like 180, no, 100 BC to like 80 or 90 AD, you know? So you're talking like almost 200 years period. Around the time of Jesus, you know, which is a really interesting period of time, I think, cosmically. There was just a lot of interesting people. It has all the, like, you know, best examples of all the best people and the worst examples of all the worst people, you know. Really intense times of history bring out the best in people and it brings out the worst in people. It kind of shows, it just heightens everybody's personality. You know, it blows it all up. And, you know, like, that's happening right now, big time in history. Right now, all the, you know, liberal people are, like, totally hardcore pushing for their agenda. And then all of the right-wing people pushing their agenda. All the Christians are saying what they really believe to everybody, you know, and just they're not hiding. Everybody's out there fighting for what they believe. And it's tumultuous. And people are having the opportunity to really shine and what they really are. And that's kind of that's what that period of history is all about. So the 12 Caesars, he calls them the 12 Caesars because those were the, basically from the beginning of the empire, the Caesars, the kings of kings, because Rome was a republic for a couple hundred years before that. And a couple hundred years before that, it was a kingdom. And then at the end of the Caesars, the period of time after the 12 Caesars, that's when you went into the five good emperors, which was pretty much like the height of the Roman Empire. So this was, the 12 Caesars kind of like, you know, tells the story of the beginning of the Roman Empire. And the beginning of really, it tells the story of the beginning, well, at least in a, not the story as in like what's going on in all of Europe, but it tells the story of the guys in charge of the period of history in Europe that when Europe became like a unified country, you know, when Europe, when the Roman Empire took over everything. So the 12 Caesars were, you know, the first emperor was Augustus, but the 12 Caesars were, he starts with Julius Caesar. He wasn't officially an emperor, but he was, you know, dictator for life and everything, and then he got killed, so he wasn't, and then they had some civil wars, and then there was the first Caesar, who was Augustus. But yeah, so they start with Julius Caesar, and then it's Augustus Caesar, and then Tiberius, and then Caligula, and then Claudius, and then Nero, and then Galba, and then Otho, and then Vitellius, and then Vespasian, and then Vitellius, and then Titus, and then Domitian. So that's the 12s. And then after that, we went into the, it was like, settled down, and it was the 12 good Caesars. I mean, the five good Caesars, the five good emperors. Pax Romana. So Edward Gibbon in 1837, when he talked Pax Romana, he was referring to the five good emperors in the hundreds, from like 100 to 200. But Pax Romana really began with like Augustus. So, you know. So anyways. Yeah, it's a really interesting book, not only because of how detailed Seutonius was. Now, Seutonius wrote the book he wrote the book in about, I think it was like 160, it was during the time, the reign of Hadrian, which was like 130 or something AD. So he wrote the book, you know, like 40 years after the last emperor of the six emperors, the Caesars, Domitian, you know, like a couple hundred years after Julius Caesar. So it was, and he got all his information from a lot of the archives, from the government archives, and then kind of compiled it, you know, as a historian. These are archives that don't even exist anymore, you know. Like, most of those guys wrote books. There's, I mean, if we could have access to all the stuff that they wrote and that had existed in the past, you know, we could, it would be like 100 times more than we have now. It's kind of one of the big tragedies of what happened with the Roman Empire, the fall of the Roman Empire, is we lost, the barbarians came in there and just destroyed and vandalized, and we lost a lot of precious literature, you know. I mean, like a lot of the famous people who've written books, you know, say like Cicero or Seutonius or these guys who write stuff, you know, we only have like, say they've written 15, 20 books, we only have like one of them, you know. And of that one book we have, we only have like 80 or 90% of it, you know. Like, I mean, our understanding of history is very fractured. It's very sparse, you know. I mean, a lot of the stuff we know about history, we only know from one person. This particular part of history, there's lots of different sources, though, that still exist. But Seutonius is one of the best, one of the biggest ones. And it's a big book. So he got it directly from the writings, you know, like from autobiographies. Most of those dudes wrote autobiographies. I didn't know that. But he was getting it from them, and... But I guess after he got to like Claudius, they took away his access from the government records, maybe because they thought he was being too critical of the Caesars, and so he had to kind of get it from word of mouth or whatever. But which shows how honest he was. I mean, you could tell that Seutonius was an honest historian. I think most of the historians those days were honest historians. They weren't, and the stuff that it survived anyways, they weren't just, you know, pandering to try to pump up some dude who was paying them to write the story about them and just lying and all that kind of stuff. I think most of them, you know, especially the ones that survived, you can pretty much, you know, take it to the bank what they said. They would, you know, if they said something negative about a guy, they just painted it in a true light, you know, because he had no reason to pump one guy up more than the other. He this was hundreds of years before he even lived. He's just a historian, you know, that's his job. And historians of all times, they, from all of history, they know how important it is to tell the real story and not just to make stuff up and to over embellish and all that kind of stuff. And I could tell from the way that he wrote that he was, you know, he didn't have an agenda. He just told it how it was and was very descriptive and very detailed. And back as a just part of the introduction, one really interesting thing about the book is that it's just a really interesting part of history. You know, we get the best of the best and the worst of the worst, you know, from the best of the best, like Augustus, who I think was the best emperor ever, the best leader from history. I remember that somebody did some list of all the greatest monarchs ever, and he got 18th place, but I would put him much higher than that. You know, I'd put him first place. And then the worst of the worst, Caligula. I'd put Caligula as the worst of the worst. So, and he was just two emperors after Augustus, so it was just extremities. You know, and Jesus lived at that time too. Jesus was born during the reign of Augustus and was preaching during the reign of Tiberius. So, and you know, Jesus wasn't the only person who was brilliant and talking about clemency and all that kind of stuff. You know, there were other, like Augustus, other great people. So anyways, that being said, let me just go through what I remember, what he said about all the 12 Caesars and my insights into it and all that kind of stuff. And by the way, I got this book off of bookshouldbefree.com, where people actually read the book. So read by different people, but, you know, they did a good job. So the first one was Julius Caesar. I think he was the first guy who came up with the name Caesar, which then turned into, like, Tsar from Russia and there's some other names that come from it. It kind of means like King of Kings. I think, I don't know if that was his, like, maybe it was his actual last name and other people just adopted it. But I think he was born from a cesarean section. That's why they call it cesarean section, because he was the most famous person to be born that way. So he was born around, I think it was like 98 BC or something. You know, around 100 BC, but Seutonius, when he writes his book, he writes about, when he talks about an emperor, he starts with talking about their dad. So I think he talked about Julius Caesar's dad. You know, maybe about the time he was born, so like 100 BC. Julius Caesar came from an ancient family of Romans. He was a noble, from a noble family. I don't know if it was patrician or equestrian or whatever. They had different ranks there. And I don't exactly know like what they signified and stuff. It was hereditary, but, but I guess his family didn't really have that much money. They were just an ancient family with a lot of prestige, but they didn't have that whole bunch of money. So he had to kind of fight his way up, you know, through the world. And if you look at in history, you know, the people who do the best, who are the most capable, are the ones who came from humble origins and fought their way up. And the people who are the most despicable are the ones who are just spoon-fed everything and cause them to go nuts. And this book is just the perfect one to describe exactly how that happened. And I will describe it. So, when I turned it that way, I was just looking at how many minutes I'm into it. Because when I turn it around, it doesn't tell me that information anymore. And I don't like to look at myself when I talk anyways. But Yeah, so Julius Caesar, he was like, you know, one of these young politicians, and when he was a young guy, he came up through, well, the social wars were going on. Those were the third of the social wars when the slave revolt, Spartacus slave revolt. Julius Caesar was like 50, like 20 years old during that. You know, remember the movie from Stars, Spartacus, and Julius Caesar was one of the guys in there? Well, yeah, he was. He was alive during that time. He didn't fight Spartacus or wasn't in those wars or anything like that, but but he was alive and stuff. At that time, there was a guy named Sulla who was a general, and who, you know, he wasn't, the generals weren't the official rulers of the country. It was consuls who were like elected, because it was a republic, and they were just like the head senators, and you know, you'd have like two of them, I think, elected for like a couple of years, 10 years or something, or I don't know, and then another few of them were elected. So when somebody's born, you would just say, oh, he was born during the consulship of him. But there's this guy, Sulla, who was actually the main guy in charge. He was the real power, you know, more powerful than the head consul. He was kind of like a dictator. So Rome was kind of going through a period where it was getting more, it was getting bigger and taking over more other countries. For example, they took over Spain. I don't know if it was Sulla who did that, but they took over southern France. They were growing, you know, they had taken over, they took over Spain and like Sicily from Carthage. And then they took over North Africa from Carthage a little bit before that. I think it was like 150, BC, and they took over Greece. So they during that time, so they're really growing. And so like generals were the guys in charge, and it was kind of becoming more and more difficult to remain a republic and tending towards being more of an autocracy. And the first guy to kind of be the autocrat was this guy Sulla, but he died as an old guy. And but he knew Julius Caesar, and he said of Julius Caesar, that guy is going to be the downfall of this republic, meaning like that guy's gonna take over the whole, turn this place back into a kingdom. Rome was a kingdom from 753, when Romulus and Remus founded it, all the way until, I think it was 509. So for like 250 years, it was a kingdom. And then it was a republic for like, you know, almost 500 years, from 509 to 27 BC. So, but you know, it was a republic. It was just, you know, it just had Italy. It wasn't an empire. So, but anyways, Julius Caesar, he had really baggy clothes. He wore his clothes really loosely. And like when Sulla referred to him, he was like, yeah, that boy with the baggy clothes, he's going to be the downfall of the Republic. He had dark hair, like really dark, dark piercing eyes. And like, he was a really good public speaker and spoke with his hands and was just very flamboyant and loud and a great, great speaker. Really charismatic and energetic, and had kind of a high-pitched voice when he would speak loudly. At one point when he was younger, he had like stayed in the same house as a king, Nicomedes from like Armenia or something. And people later used that to try to say that he was gay. People in those days, it's kind of like the oldest way to slander somebody is try to accuse them of being gay. And then one time when he was young, he was taken by pirates and held for like over a month by them. And, he would joke with them like, oh, they were like, oh, we're going to get 20 denarii from you. And he's like, ha ha ha, I'm worth at least 50 denarii. And he sent his people out to go get their 50 denarii. But he was joking that he would crucify them as soon as they let him go. And they let him go for the 50 denarii. And as soon as he went home, he collected some boats and went back there and captured those same pirates and crucified them. And just like he said, and he had a dream when he was younger that he was having sex with his mother. And he asked the augurs. The augurs were like the people who would like cut open intestines of animals and throw them on a table. And according to how the intestines looked, they could kind of predict the future. And I think they were also like prophets and stuff. And so they told him that that meant that he was going to take over the whole world, because his mother was in the dream signified the whole world, you know, like Mother Earth, and that he was, you know, he was like taking over Mother Earth. And so he was like, oh, cool, I'll take over the world. And so after that, he tried to get elected as like a consul at a really young age, and he was just extremely like arrogant as a kid. And there were these other consuls who were like a lot richer and older than him, and he was telling him that he was going to beat them at the elections, and he beat them in votes for in their own districts, and then got himself like elected as like the general of as the governor of southern France, like the whole boss of the whole thing, which was a really prestigious thing to do. And at one point when he was in the East, he visited Alexander the Great's tomb in Alexandria and started like crying, and somebody's like, why are you crying? He's like, I'm older than him. He was like 38 or something. Alexander died at 32. I'm older than him, and I haven't done anything. And he, by the time he was my age, he'd conquer the whole world. Oh no, woe is me. So, he was the governor of like southern France, and then southern France had the Germans invaded. Ariovistus invaded, and so he used that as a reason to invade southern France and to fight off Ariovistus to protect the southern French and the Celts and all that, and then ended up invading all of France and taking over all of France and modern day Belgium, and he even subdued England, but he didn't have the chance to go back there and actually subdue them completely and set up a government over there. So they weren't part of the Roman Empire under him, but he did take them. He did defeat them. Anyways, that's another book. Seutonius doesn't talk about that at all, and I've already talked about that in the words of Julius Caesar. But what Seutonius writes in the book, though, I think what he really kind of, when he really starts to get in the detail of the politics of the political life of Julius Caesar, is when he comes back and takes over the country. So he came back, and he had an alliance with the guy who is now kind of like the new dictator of Rome, Pompey, who was one of the greatest generals, because he, like in 30 days, defeated all the pirates in the Mediterranean, and they'd have like a big pirate problem before that. But he wasn't really a threat to Pompey. Pompey was married to Julius Caesar's daughter, but she died. And so that alliance went away while Julius Caesar was still, she died in childbirth, I think, when he was still in France. And so as he was coming back, they were saying that they were going to take his armies away from him. And he'd have to come back without an army. And he kind of freaked out and thought that like they were kind of threatened by him, because he had just taken over France. And so they thought if he came back to Italy with all of his armies, he'd take over Italy as well from Pompey. And he said that wasn't his intention. He was just going to come back with his army. But they told him that he couldn't. So maybe he was scared that if he came back alone, they would just assassinate him, because they assassinate each other all the time. So he was thinking about coming back with his army, but if he knew if he did that, that would have meant war. I guess he wanted to take over all of Italy. But so he stopped at this river called the Rubicon River, which is in northern Italy. Nobody really knows where it is, because it was just a small stream at the time. But that was the boundary, the southern boundary of the part of northern Italy and southern France that, and Switzerland, that was his province. And so he knew if he crossed it with his army, that meant war. So he sat at the other side of the river for a long time, kind of pondering what to do with his army. At which point, a really famous lyre player, musician, who was I don't know if he was living in the area or was part of the army, but he came and he just grabbed the horn, which the horn that signals for people to charge. He grabbed the horn and ran to the river and signaled the horn to charge. And Julius Caesar was like, okay, well, I guess that's the sign. Because I think he was asking for a sign. And he said, so the dice is cast. We go. And he crossed and he went across the border and was charging for Rome, which scared Pompey because he didn't have a big army like Julius Caesar did. And so Pompey and all the other guys who said he couldn't ran, I think they fled to like Greece. And then Julius Caesar pursued him, and they had a battle, which Julius Caesar was outnumbered by Pompey, and I think these other guys, Cato and some other people, other senators, but he ended up winning anyways because all of his troops were a lot more experienced. They had just come back from taking over France, and they're better fighters. And Pompey's guys ran, and Julius Caesar said afterwards, like, oh my God, and this guy calls himself a good warrior? How pathetic. He's lucky he doesn't fight me before. And then Pompey fled to, you can see it all in that miniseries from HBO, Rome, but Alexandria, and then they assassinated him in Alexandria and to try to appease Julius Caesar. And Julius Caesar went there to try to kind of reconcile with him, but he'd already been killed. So I think he had the guy who killed him killed and was really sad about Pompey dying because they were old friends. And then he went back to Rome and kind of basically took over Rome and became like dictator for life. So, you know, he was pretty much like the real first Caesar. But it wasn't like official, you know, like official Roman Empire, official Caesar. He was just kind of like the top dictator guy. But he was ruling as an autocrat. And I think he was in Rome for like 5 years or something as the top guy. And the populace loved him because he was really rich from taking over France, because he had taken, you know, take over a whole country, kill 5 million people or 1 million people out of 5 million people who lived there, and confiscate all their goods. And, you know, now you're taxing them and all the taxes, you have control of the taxes. He was just really rich. So he was paying his soldiers lavishly. I think it was he started the first professional army in Italy, and you know, giving games and food and stuff to people. So the people loved him, and he was just a really flamboyant guy. But they got together and they assassinated him. And oh, but more things about Julius Caesar as a person. He liked to wear the crown of laurel crown, like the of the little leaves and stuff around his head, and he also to try to cover up his bald spot. He had a bald spot that he was really really self-conscious about, and he even did a comb over. He grew his hair long around the sides and then combed it up in front to try to hide it. And he was tall. He was like 5'7", which I guess in those days was tall. The average like soldier was like 5'5". I heard it was like 5'7", but yeah, maybe like shorter than that, like 5'5". Romans weren't that tall because they lived on grain, not a whole lot of protein like the French and the Germans. I think Germans on the average were like 6 inches taller than the Romans. But he was an amazing person. This isn't really what Seutonius says. I'll kind of include other stuff I know about these guys if it's interesting. But I'll mention if he, you know, it's mentioned in his book or not. But he was an interesting guy. But he was a really capable person, very intelligent. By the time he was, like when he was 40, he'd never even been in a war before or commanded an army. He was just a politician and was given that consulship of northern Italy when he was 40 and had his first battles. And he was one of the greatest generals ever. He only lost, and this is written in Seutonius, he only had 2 military defeats in his entire 8 years in Gaul, or in his entire life. He won every war. He was like Charlemagne. He won every single battle he was in, with the exception of 2. One at Gergovia, but he says in his book it was because his guys didn't listen to him when he said to retreat from the charge on an uphill battle from one of these hilltop forts in Gergovia, and 700 of his guys were killed. And then in another time, I can't remember, somewhere in Gaul, one of his like armies was routed. But you know, those were kind of minor defeats. So he was a brilliant general, even though he didn't fight his first war till he was 40. He was a brilliant speaker, and he was a brilliant politician. And he came up from like poor roots, you know. He didn't have money. He was like way in debt. He borrowed a lot to get to, to get his elections and get what he had and all that. So he was a big risk taker, and it played out for him. He wrote the Wars, the Gaelic Wars, which is a pretty big book. It's like 7 hours solid. So. And, you know, when you read from the book, he knew exactly what he was doing, and he was a very good tactician and politician and just a brilliant person. But he was also he had a lot of clemency. He was very forgiving. He wanted to, as soon as he would defeat his opponents, he would just bring them back into his fold under his wing. But they ended up assassinating him on 15th of March, Ides of March. It's my roommate's birthday. And because he was too much of a dictator, and they didn't like dictators at the time. They weren't used to it. They were used to the Republic of Rome, and all the different senators wanted to, you know, have a voice, their own voice. When he was assassinated, one guy came up to him to ask for like pardon for his brother, and he refused. And then they all surrounded him, and he stabbed him. And I guess he was stabbed like 47 times or something, but they were all surface wounds because they stabbed him with their styluses. There were these, like the pen that they used in those days, they would carve into like clay tablets, which would kind of, you could also use them as daggers, but only the second one that he was stabbed with was like, ended up being a mortal wound. They all wanted to get a stab in so that no one person could be kind of singled out as the murderer of Julius Caesar, because he was so popular. They knew if it was one guy, he would get vengeance would be upon him. So it took a lot of courage. And in another book, I don't know which one it was, but like, yeah, it did take a lot of courage. Like when they first came up to him, they were like, oh my God, this is Julius Caesar. Are we really going to do this? But they did it, and they killed him. The thing about Seutonius is he sells all the details, you know, like they say, you know, like one guy says this and one guy said that. So it was very, very, objective the way that Seutonius, reported about stuff. And so I think, like some people say, like he said, and you Brutus, you too Brutus, like et tu Brute, but, Brutus's mother was Julius Caesar's lover. So he had known Brutus for a long time, and he thought they were friends, but Brutus was one of the main, planners. The people who are credited in history as being the main planners of the assassination were Brutus and Cassius, I think. But other people say he didn't say anything, and he just covered his head and died. Out of all those senators that murdered him, none of them lived past 3 years. They were all sought out and murdered by the people. The people that had no, it was a huge miscalculation that they did. They didn't know what they were doing when they did that. They didn't have any plan. You know, they didn't have a designated head of state or head of the Senate after that. They just wanted to get rid of the dictator because they didn't like the idea of having a dictator, because they were a republic for so many 250 years or for like 500 years, long time. And they were afraid of turning into a kingdom again. They knew how bad, you know, that they came out of a kingdom, and they were having dictators before that. But they didn't have a plan. And the populace, you know, like the heads of the armies and stuff, the centurions, who are the kings of the leaders of the 100 troops and stuff, they had their own kind of power too, and they turned against him and fought him, and they there was kind of this power vacuum. And there was one guy, his one of his lieutenants, one of Julius Caesar's generals, was Mark Antony, and he was pretty much the most powerful politician in Rome after that. And they most people thought that he basically wanted to be the next king. So it was becoming evident that that in the new empire that they had, you know, because now they had Spain, they had France, they had Greece, they had Africa, they had all the area around. They had like the whole Mediterranean was an empire that they couldn't. And that the technology that they had in those days, they couldn't have a republic anymore. They had to be an autocracy with one guy in charge, because it would just fall apart. They'd have too many civil wars. They'd have been having civil wars for a long time, almost constantly, since like Sulla. Sulla was fighting these huge civil wars, and he took over and killed a bunch of, you know, fellow Italian senators, and now Julius Caesar just had a civil war against Pompey and those guys that he won, and now they didn't have another power vacuum, and now they have this Mark Antony guy who wants to be the big guy, and people were starting to get sick of it. It was like 100 years of civil wars, and Julius Caesar had designated an heir, though, and so he was really popular, so they wanted to. You know, his memory meant a lot, and he had his heir was his sister's daughter's son. So his grand nephew. He had left all of it to him, who he had been on a few campaigns with, and just he was his closest male relative. And was this guy named Octavius who was in Illyrium, which was like modern day like Albania or something, at the time, who was 19. And so when they told him that Julius Caesar had just been assassinated, while Julius Caesar this isn't in Seutonius' book, but when Julius Caesar was in Greece, in Egypt, when he went after there to try to capture Pompey, but they killed him. He stayed there for 6 months and had sex with Cleopatra and did a 6 month barge tour up the Nile with Cleopatra and had a baby with her named Caesarion. Anyways, but when he was killed, they told his grandnephew that he had been killed and that everything was his estate was left to him. And so the kid was like, huh, okay, well, what should I do? Should I go there and claim it? If I do, I'll probably could die. There's a big chance that I'll get killed by Mark Antony and those guys. But if I stay here, they'll probably kill me anyway because I'll be a threat because now I'm the heir to the old Caesar. So one of the generals down there tried to talk him out of it, and his mother tried to talk him out of it, but he was like, you know what, fuck it, I'll go anyway. And so that was Augustus. He ended up becoming Augustus. So Octavius, he came from humble beginnings himself. His, his mother was wealthy and stuff, but all the money and wealth came through your father's line. So he was only connected, but he wasn't like totally plugged in. So which was, I think, in history, a good position to be in for if you're a really capable person. You know, you want to have like the doors open to you, but you have to fight for it. But at the time, I think his mother was married to somebody else, and his stepfather claimed direct descendancy from Alexander the Great, and was the governor of the province of like Illyrium, you know, the province of Rome in modern day Albania, and so, you know, he was a popular politician and stuff. And I think he tried to talk him out of going into Italy, but he went anyway, and he gathered up a big army. And you know, I mean, it didn't take much long at all. You know, 3 weeks after Caesar was killed, he was already in Italy with a big army, and he was like, "Yo, what's up, Mark Antony?" And so Mark Antony was like a little bit threatened, but Mark Antony and Caesarion, they had to team up with each other to fight against all the Brutus and all the other guys, Cassius and. Because Mark Antony was pissed off that they killed Caesar too, because Mark Antony was Caesar's right-hand man. I think Mark Antony was there, actually, at the assassination of Caesar, but he couldn't do anything because he was outnumbered. At least that's how it was portrayed in that movie, that TV show Rome. But yeah, Caesar actually, there's rumors, and this is written in Seutonius, that Caesar actually had dreams that he was going to be killed, and somebody actually gave him a plot, gave him the plot to kill him, that all he had to do was open it up and read it, but he didn't. He didn't have time, and he went to the forum anyway and got killed. That's actually shown in the miniseries from HBO Rome. When you see these miniseries, HBO Rome and I, Claudius and all this kind of stuff and all the little details of things that happened, most of those things actually did happen. They took them right out of the history books. But they did take a lot of liberties too. So, you know, don't just like expect everything, but a lot of it did. So anyways, those guys teamed up and they created a triumvirate. It was like the second triumvirate because they had another triumvirate 100 years before with Sulla and some other guys. So it was Octavius, Mark Antony, and a guy named Lepidus who was one of the the governor of like Gaul at the time, who was an older guy, and I think that lasted about 5 years, but then I think they gave Lepidus like Africa or something, and then they kicked Lepidus out, and it was just Mark Antony. They like banished Lepidus And then it was just Mark Antony and Octavius. And Mark Antony went over to Egypt and fell in love with Cleopatra. And then Mark Antony started doing lots of really stupid shit. And see, the thing about Octavius, Augustus, is that he was known as like the luckiest. He was very capable and brilliant, but he was also like the luckiest dude. King ever, you know, like when people say, oh, I hope you have the luck of Augustus, because in his entire life, all of the little, pieces just fell into place perfectly for him. Ever since the very beginning, you know, from Julius Caesar dying and bequeathing his estate to him, even though Julius Caesar had other kids maybe before him that had died, I don't know the exact who they were, but and then of course Mark Antony making it so easy. Like if it hadn't have been for Mark Antony being such an idiot, Mark Antony probably would have taken over Rome and Octavius would have been by the wayside, because he was only 19 when Julius Caesar was killed. So yeah, Mark Antony basically went crazy and went over to Egypt and like tried and like fell in love with Cleopatra and just moved to Egypt. And I think he even brought Cleopatra back to Rome for a while and was parading with her, you know, and she was like a foreign, she was from Egypt, and so she was darker skinned and, different hair, different clothing styles. And, you know, the Romans had their own specific clothing style, and they would get a little bit like threatened when they'd see somebody from another part of the world, you know, parading around town with their top-notch guy. And he pissed off one guy named Cicero, who made this thing called the Philippics, which was just a series of speeches just designed to just slander Mark Antony and make him look out to be a total idiot. You know, like, Mark Antony, you drank until you puked, and you puked in front of everybody, getting food all over your clothing. And you did that in a public space. It's bad enough to do it in private. You're just a brute. And then he like fought a failed campaign against the Parthians and moved to Egypt and like the rumor had it that, and I think it was kind of clear to everybody because he wasn't cooperating with Rome, that he wanted to just break off and start his own kingdom in Italy, in Egypt with Cleopatra. He was basically Cleopatra's tool, puppet. She had some crazy way to like control the guys around her. She did it with Julius Caesar, and now she's doing it with Mark Antony. And Mark Antony like started like dressing like Egyptians and acting like Egyptians. And he was also a very extravagant guy who wasted a lot of money in banquets, had huge banquets. Now, I didn't get this information from Seutonius. I got this from another historical book from the time. But yeah, he would just waste tons of money. They'd have like 20 boars, and he just partied all the time. he grew his beard out really long and his hair out really long at one point. And so all the Romans and Cicero and all the senators and Octavius, it gave him a perfect, and a lot of historians say, oh yeah, it gave him a perfect opportunity to take the power from Antony. But I think they were generally had reason to say, you know, this guy's lost his shit. He's going to try to break up the empire. You know, he's going to try to undermine Rome, and he's a Roman, you know? So, and he calls himself a Roman. He calls himself the one of the leaders of Rome, but he is out there basically becoming an Egyptian and not coming back here. Octavius sent Mark Antony, his sister, to marry, to try to have like a union. And Mark Antony had already married Cleopatra and just sent her back to Rome and said, you know, get lost. And so it just pissed off all the Romans and they had a war, a battle with Mark Antony in the western side of Greece called the Battle of Actium, where they went over there and they blocked him in and they tried to escape, and they were outnumbered by, they had bigger boats, but the Romans had more boats. And so they're outnumbered and were defeated in that battle. And I think like Cleopatra like fled and didn't back him up when he needed to. And then a lot of his generals turned against him. He like lost respect. And then they had another skirmish back in Alexandria, and then you know, it was all lost for him. So they committed suicide, and that was an interesting story. Just in that, how they committed suicide, it was funny as hell. Like he tried to stab himself, and then when they found him, he wasn't dead. They said Cleopatra's dead. She poisoned herself. He's like, she's dead. So he stabbed himself, and as he was dying, they said, oh, no, she's not dead. He's like, she's not dead. Well, then help me go. I want to see her one last time. So he's bleeding to death, and he's almost dead. And he went to, like, Cleopatra's, like, tower where she was hiding, because at that time Octavian was there besieging the tower because he desperately wanted to capture Cleopatra alive so he could parade her through the streets of Rome in his triumphant parade. So she was hiding there, but he snuck in the back, and like he wasn't strong enough to climb up the rope because he had lost all his blood and was dying. And so the girls pulled him up in the rope, but they're all a bunch of girls, and they barely pulled him into the tower, and he died in her arms right there. And then she poisoned herself and they died. And the people who said it was just the most pathetic ending of any like guy who used to be a macho leader. And it was just sad. But anyways, so, you know, it was just so now Octavius is the leader of all of the known Rome. You know, they didn't have, he was the heir of Julius Caesar. He had no rivals. All of his big rivals had basically shot themselves in the foot. And so he was basically like the first guy. And I think that was like, I don't know how long, but then a few years go by, and in 27 BC, this is the beginning of the Roman Empire. 27 BC, he says to all of the different senators, okay, well, it is time for me to now relinquish my power and just become a private citizen, and you guys can take over the country. And we can have the Republic again. And all of the senators were like, oh shit, well now we're going to have another power vacuum. And I think they foresaw maybe there'd be another like civil war. Because whenever there's a power vacuum like that, all the guys clamor and then they fight. And they'd have so many civil wars. And Octavius had shown himself at that point to be a brilliant leader. And they said, okay, no, you be our leader. You be our leader. So they kind of drew up a new constitution where they made him like first among equals, like for life. So it was a more autocratic constitution than they'd had in all of the Republican era. So they basically, he was a king, So they had gone back to being a kingdom, and so he was the emperor. But he was, this was in 27 BC, and so he was in charge for a long time because he died in 1480. So he was in, he was the emperor from, for 37, 41. So he was the emperor for 41 years, and he was the boss before that, pretty much from 44, which is 27, 37, 17. So 41, 51, 61, 58. So he was basically the leader of Rome for 58 years. From since he was 19 years old until he was, until he died when he was 75, 1 month shy of being 76. So, you know, and he was like the top dog guy. I don't know when the Battle of Actium was, but I should know that. But so you know, he had been in charge of Rome as an autocrat for a really long time, and he was a brilliant person. He was a genius. Just like Julius Caesar. I think Julius Caesar was a genius too. But Augustus was a super genius. He because he was super capable. He really did have the best of Rome at heart. And so Seutonius talks about all of the details of all the stuff that he said and the decrees he made and everything. And he did it all for the good of Rome. Because he was so amazing of a leader, they gave him the title Father of His Country. You know, like he's literally the father of the country because he made all the decisions to put in place everything that made Rome an actual empire. Before Augustus, Rome was just kind of like a kingdom, and the city of Rome was just like a nice city. But during the reign of Augustus, because and he was like the perfect autocrat, you know, everything worked smooth. When you have a perfect autocrat, the benevolent dictator, everything can work way smoothly and quicker than if you have a bunch of squabbling politicians, because you know it's just, you know, you're a lot more decisive, and the power structure is just, it's just really efficient, and if all the decisions are made correctly, and he made them all correctly, and he was brilliant, and he started the first police force in Rome. He started the first fire brigade in Rome. He started the first Pony Express, you know, the first postal service in the empire, with really, and he set it up in a way that had never been done before, in like a revolutionary way, like where you'd have extra fast carriages, and the people who would send the letters would actually witness the writing of the letters. So if you had any extra questions, the guy could help elaborate, because he was there when it was dictated. And he changed the taxation system. Until then, taxes were such that in all the different provinces, the king, or you know, the Rome would say, okay, well, you give us so and so amount of money, and if they wanted to give them, if the tax collector could get more, then they didn't have a problem with that. They're like, get as much as you want, but we expect the minimum or whatever. So the tax collectors were abusing the taxes they would get, and which would cause strife, you know, and rebellions and all this kind of stuff. And he set up a system that was, that there was just a whole lot of oversight, so that there was a lot of communication between the Rome and the governors of the provinces, so that the governor could not get away with overtaxing. And the governor had to tax exactly how much he said to tax. And it was a consistent amount you would get every year, and it was like scientifically based. And so it was fair to everybody, worked very smoothly. It was the first time that the empire was working really smoothly. He set up 28 colonies within Italy itself, so 28 new cities. So the, you know, the population grew a lot. Minted like a national coins, the empire itself grew under him as well. He set boundaries for Rome, and built walls and trenches and stuff around. He had one big setback. I don't know when it was. I think it was like 16 BC or something like that. They lost Germany. They had the Rhine River was always the beginning of Germany and the end of the Roman Empire for the entire Roman Empire. But for about 30 years, beginning, I think a little bit after Julius Caesar, they had actually, one of their provinces was called Germany Inferior. They had they took over Germany on the eastern side of the Rhine, all the way up until, I think, the River Elbe, which is like a couple hundred miles east of the Rhine River. And so they had Germany. Germany was their country, but the Germans rebelled because they were the Romans were crucifying them instead of just using their system of Wehrgeld. When they would like kill each other or have fights and stuff, they would in Germany they would just fine them the amount of money for whatever the money that you owed the guy was worth if you killed him or whatever. But the Romans were doing the crucifixion thing, which I guess the Italians would scare people into lying, but it just pissed off the Germans and they rebelled. And they had this guy named Varus, who was the governor of that of Germany Inferior, who was a total idiot. If they had a smart guy, they never would have lost Germany. But he was a total moron, and he was duped into chasing after one of his right hand man, Germanicus, who was a German born Roman. Who was pissed off? Who like far as pissed off or whatever? Decided he was more loyal to Germany after all, and so he was in on it. And he talked Varus into chasing after some band of Germans who he said were trying to rebel. And Varus ended up taking all three of his legions, his entire army, out into the middle of the woods, like thick woods, where they were all strung out in a really thin line and. Like, stuff that Julius Caesar never would have done. Like, if you were a smart soldier, general, you never would have done that. And they got cut down, ambushed and cut down, and he lost all... Everybody died. Like, all three legions, which is like 15, 20,000 dudes died. And that happened during the reign of Augustus, and it totally freaked out Augustus. He thought that like maybe the entire empire was at stake because, the rumor would get around that it was actually possible to defeat a Roman army. So now, maybe the Gauls, the French are going to rebel. And so he scrambled to change all the different laws within Rome. Like he discontinued all of the German bodyguards within Rome. He like brought more soldiers within Rome to try to keep the peace within Rome, to stop riots inside of the city of Rome, and it was like a major, major disaster. And especially, I guess it was especially stressful for him. He didn't shave or cut his hair for months after that, and he would like have insomnia and walk up and down the hallway of his palace and bang his head against the wood frame of his door, screaming, "Bavarus, give me back my legion, give me back my eagles!" But that was the only like setback that he had. He also like dammed up the Tiber River and built up. Stopped flooding. I guess every once in a while the Tiber River would flood into the Forum, and then it would rot the wooden building. So they decided that Rome wasn't fit to be an imperial city. So he wanted to rebuild the whole thing in marble. So he was the first person to really start building most of the big buildings, like the Forum buildings and stuff, in marble instead of wood, because it wouldn't burn down as easily, and because it wouldn't get rotten whenever the Tiber would flood. If you go to Rome, the Forum is actually kind of like, it's at the bottom of the Palatine Hill, which is next to the river. So it's kind of like one of the dips between rivers. So I guess like in the early days, and when Romulus went there, it was just marshland. And so he built extensive building works, built And so he bragged that he's found Rome a city of wood and left it a city of marble. And that was a literal saying, but also people took it figuratively, and like he solidified the actual empire. Like he just changed everything and made everything run perfectly, and set up, switched out a whole lot of different rules, and he lowered the age of senators or judges from 35 to 30 years old. He made rules that children of senators got to go to all of the meetings within the Senate to try to educate them to become good senators when they grew up. He encouraged senators to debate with each other, and he sat within the other senators. He didn't sit in the middle. He sat with the senators to try to be just another senator, even though he had autocratic power. And because he knew that there was still that sentiment of republicanism, and if he was too kind of gregarious or too, you know, autocratic, that he might actually end up getting assassinated himself, just like Julius Caesar was. And, you know, and a lot of people did have a lot of big problems with him and accused him of being an autocrat in those days. And he was very forgiving of him. He said he allowed people to publicly criticize him. And, you know, and if they pissed him off, he'd just say, "Hey, I have a tongue too. I can defend myself." And so he was just the perfect leader. You know, he didn't kill people, just for no reason at all. He was a big patron of the arts. He paid a lot of money to build up, to have lots of like games for people and show, and, gladiatorial games and theatrical shows. He was really into the theater and took it really seriously. Like if certain actors, like one actor, married like was too licentious, was like pointed at the crowd, and it was like an embarrassing thing for him to do. He had his like legs broken, and he killed one of his freedmen because he was having sex with too many other married men. One of the only, and this is kind of a testament to him, because the only way that they could actually criticize him was kind of like Bill Clinton. Bill Clinton's a good president. The only way they could actually criticize him was personal issues, the Monica Lewinsky thing. The only thing they could really criticize Augustus was personal reasons. He was having sex with a lot of other senators' wives. But his excuse, and I guess his supporters' excuse, was, well, he was having sex with them so that he would get them to confide in him to know what they were all planning. It was a way of him to be in tune with everything. And also, when he got younger, he was constantly bringing tons of virgins to have sex with him, to deflower girls. But I don't think that's that bad in those days, you know? I mean, these girls probably wanted to anyways. You know how women get around guys in power. So, but he was also really like frugal, and he kind of wanted to be just another person. He wasn't one of these wasteful kings who was tried to be like a god among men, you know, better than everybody else. He lived on the Palatine Hill, but he lived in a normal house just like everybody else, and he lived in a normal bed just like everybody else, like a normal straw bed. And he tried to, and when people tried to refer to him like with a title, you know, like in England, they call you like my lord Henry VIII. Whenever they called him like, you know, divine Augustus or whatever, he would actually punish them for saying that. And he wouldn't allow any of his family members to refer to him as that, or anybody refer to him as that in public. He just wanted them to refer to him as a normal person and not be intimidated by him or treat him separately or anything. And, but, you know, he was kind of like treated like a god in those days. He made sure to have his statue shipped out to all of the different towns all over the empire. Like I said, he was really lucky. There's lots of different stories about how fortune was just totally on his side. Like at one point, he was like in the Swiss Alps, and one Gaul like had been granted permission to meet with him, with the idea of grabbing him and throwing him off a cliff. But when he met him, he looked in his eyes and he saw like a very serene, peaceful, and like an intelligent person, and he couldn't bring himself to do it. And like, he was too kingly. And that's how he was described in his person. Like, his eyes were really deep and intelligent and calm and like regal. And he was very handsome. And Seutonius says that he was 5'9", which is really tall for a Roman. In the Wikipedia article, they said he was short, but so I remember Seutonius saying he was 5'9". Julius Caesar was 5'7". But he wore like really high-heeled boots, shoes to make himself appear even taller. And he was a monobrow. He was a unibrow. And he had like curly, like sandy-colored hair. And had like a full face, and had pretty good health, although in his later years he became more unhealthy and would get really cold when it was cold and really hot when it was too hot, and in the wintertime he'd have to wear like 4 togas. But he loved his togas. He was really patriotic. At one point, he saw a whole bunch of, he looked in the crowd, and he saw a bunch of Romans just dressed in like normal coats, and he reprimanded them all for not being Roman enough and that they should wear their togas, because toga was the elegant dress of the imperial rulers of the nations. And like everything he did was for the good of the country. He was a big patron of the arts. He built a lot of theaters. He finished Pompey's theater and finished temples. And I don't think he wanted to have a temple for himself made, though. But as lucky as he was, and he'd actually he'd escaped some assassination attempts when he was younger as well, just through chance and luck. But anyways. He was as lucky as he was as a politician. He was not lucky in personal life. His first wife he married when she was like 15. He divorced because she nagged him all the time. She was like a major bitch. So maybe he was kind of like a softy too. You know, he wasn't one of these intimidating, like people who'd walk all over people. He tried to hear other people's side, but he divorced her after having a child with her. And then he married another woman when she was 19, named Livia, I think, who already had a son, who ended up being the next emperor, Tiberius. But his daughter that he had from his first wife and his first wife were like rich brats, basically. She was like a total nympho. She would like have, like he tried to make a decree to not have any like sexual things going on, like public displays of sexuality within the forum. And his own daughter would have orgies in that forum, so she was like a big embarrassment to him. And she kept, like, it was his daughter who actually had a competition with some other woman, and this is in the show I, Claudius, of like who could have as sex with as many guys, who could have sex with more guys in like a 24-hour period. If you see the TV show I, Claudius, you can see it on YouTube. It's from the 70s. Derek Jacobi is... stars as Claudius, and this other like corpulent, like jolly guy just starred as Augustus. But yeah, they showed how like the whole drama within the family of the girls being sexual nymphos. So he ended up banishing his daughter off to some island, and where she wasn't allowed to see any men, she wasn't allowed to dress in any like fancy clothes or eat any fancy food or have sex with any men. And any man who went to attend her, he had to be like reported on exactly how he looked and what he was like. I think he would only allow like ugly men to go hang out with her. And she was there for like 5 years, and then he let her back. But then she ended up disappointing him. I think he just banished her and his first wife. But he was married to his second wife for the rest of his life, even though she was never able to give him any of his own kids. When he was like 56 years old, his mother died and his sister died. So I guess his mother lived a long time. He was very loyal to them. And I think he made even temples to them or something. I don't know after that. But yeah, he was a nice guy. He brought... captives from the Parthian Empire, which is like the big rival empire in the Middle East, and allowed them to sit in the rows above him in the Roman shows for the gladiatorial combats. He had a lot of gladiatorial combats, but that was before they outlawed those kinds of, where they would let knights fight in the gladiatorial combats, not just slaves. And he allowed one knight to fight who was only 2 feet tall and 17 pounds, but had a really loud voice. And at one point in Ostia, in the port of Rome, there was this a killer whale, a female killer whale, got trapped in the port. And I don't think, no, this was written by Seutonius, though. I listened to this in a Wikipedia article, but they brought him out with a bunch of little boats, and her spigot, her water, like, sunk one of the little boats, but he ended up, like, fighting it himself and, like, killed it. And he tried to, it was Claudius. Okay, anyway. So, he was the boss, big boss guy, for his whole life, but all of his favorite heirs just started just dying magically. He didn't have a clear heir. One of his heirs was this guy named Germanicus, which was a really famous, powerful, popular general from the Rhine area, and he was the guy who went into Germany and recovered found where they fought, where they got destroyed by the Germans, where Varus's three legions were destroyed by the Germans. He went into that battlefield and recovered bones and relics, and found the standards, found the eagles, which is like the symbol of the army, and brought them back. And so that was a big point of honor. And I think he was the governor of the province of Syria, but he was poisoned, and he died prematurely at like the age of like 34 or 38 or something. And before he died, he accused Piso, this guy named Piso, another politician, of poisoning him. And they all thought, they couldn't prove it. He was kind of like the Kennedy assassination. They couldn't prove it, but they all knew that he was poisoned, because before he died, he broke out in all these hives and stuff, which is like something that happens when a certain poison gets you. And when they cremated him, his heart wasn't burnt, which I guess means that he was poisoned by some kind of poison. It had hardened his heart. I don't know. I mean, I don't know how scientific they were. They weren't quite as scientific in those days as they are in these days. So it's kind of up for speculation. But it's also, they're scientific enough, smart people. So the poison must have done something to harden his arteries or whatever, and make his heart not burn. But so Piso came back. They brought Piso back and brought him on trial. And I think he denied it. But then they ended up killing him for it. But Germanicus was supposed to be, and this is a Suetonius's words, like the greatest man who ever lived, the most forgiving and kindest and smartest and greatest general, ever. And he would have just been the even better than Augustus, amazing person. And it was just the greatest tragedy ever that he would have died, and that he died. Anyway, that guy, he was Caligula's dad, who was the third emperor, who was a psycho boy. But, so, anyways, towards the end of his life, he ended up finally declaring Tiberius as his heir, who was his wife's son. And Tiberius was a really popular, or a really capable general also, who had won a lot of important battles up in the north, up in France and Germany as well. And he was the second emperor, so I'll talk about him after. That was his last choice, because Tiberius was not a good politician, though. He was a really grumpy guy. Not very good with people and really cruel. Which was not very different from Augustus. Gracchus was not a cruel person. He was a very nice, forgiving, you know, he allowed people to argue against him and slander him and get away with it. And, but he was very, like, Tiberius tried to, there was some other king, and Tiberius was, I don't know, one of the governors out east, and tried to tell Augustus that this guy tried to get Augustus to give some service to some king. And Augustus said, if I'm going to do anything for this guy, he has to tell me himself and give me all of his reasons. And if it makes sense to me, then I will grant it to him. So everything Augustus did, it was very methodical, it was very scientific, and he I think everything he did, from the way that Suetonius writes, he tried to do it as an example, to set an example for how the perfect Roman politician should behave. And because I think he knew how important of a figure he was literally the father of the country, the architect of the whole Roman Empire, and he was trying to set an example for all of the other guys to follow, because it was really important. So anyways, he died like 1 month before turning 76. I guess he died slowly, with all of his people around him saying, "Oh, if only everybody could die peacefully. I wish everybody could die peacefully as I am." It was, I had a great life with you, my dearest Livia. How is your daughter? Or how is so-and-so? And then I guess at one point he freaked out and said, "Oh no, they're taking me out of the castle. They're taking me out. Oh no." And they calmed him down. But I guess he thought he had already died or something. He was saying 40 men are carting me out. But when he died, 40 men did cart him out to go cremate him. But that's about all. There's one other thing I remember about him is that, like when he banished his daughter, all of the people tried to talk him into not doing it, like to let her back in town and forgive her. And he always said the same thing: "If only you could have my daughter as your daughter, then you would understand." And one of her friends at one point like hung herself, and he said, "Oh, I wish that she was my daughter, not my own daughter." So he was very, like, strict with his own family members. So, I mean, to me, he seems like the perfect leader, like a perfect genius. So then the next guy who took over after him was Tiberius, who I think was already like a middle-aged guy. If the battery dies, then I'll just have to finish it tomorrow. I'll just talk until the battery dies, but... So the guy after him was Tiberius. And I don't know, I think he was already like a middle-aged dude by the time he took over power. But Tiberius, they say he didn't even want to be emperor. He was like the last choice. And I think Augustus even admitted like he was his last choice. Because Tiberius was a really cruel person, and Augustus knew, and Augustus tried to tell Tiberius to be like not so vengeful against people. But so Tiberius took over, and people already didn't really like him that much. But so there were lots of like attempted coups on him, and whenever somebody would do an attempted coup or say something bad about him, he wasn't as forgiving as Augustus. He would just kill them, and then he would kill somebody, which would get people even more pissed off at him. So he'd kill them. So he ended up moving to this island, Capri, which is not so far from Rome, where he could be protected and not have to worry about people being assassinated and stuff. But he continued like assassinating people in Capri, and he ended up assassinating like the entire royal family, like all of his own family members. And whenever he would assassinate people, he would like torture them in his chamber in the palace up on Capri, and then have them, and then they would cuss him out, and then he would like not even defend himself. He'd just be like, "Oh, whatever, be gone with him." And then they'd throw him off the cliff into the water. And if the person survived the fall, when they swam up, the people would beat him to death with their oars or their boats. And, um, And he just, everybody hated him, but I guess, you know, since he was the autocrat, he was, you know, he kept the system of Rome working well, and Rome itself was doing very well under Tiberius. So, you know, if I'd have to grade Tiberius overall as a good guy or a bad guy, I would say Tiberius was a good guy, because when he died, there was like a $200 million surplus, Sesterces surplus, in the state coffers. You know, he just ran the country well and frugally and everything. He was just a psycho, and he enjoyed torturing people too. He didn't just kill people. He would like torture them. He would give them extra wine to drink, and get them really, really drunk on wine, but then tie up their urethra and make them so they would die from all of the urine, like bursting their bladder, and like lots of different creative ways of killing people, and just like reveled in it. And he was a drunkard himself. When he was in the army, they called him Biberius, which was the total opposite of Augustus. Augustus, if he had more than a pint, he would get a stomach ache. And Augustus was just a perfectly austere, perfectly reasonable guy. But Tiberius was this, like, a really big, largely built, good looking, but just intimidating, like angry, drunken, mean, torturing dude who everybody hated, especially all of the other politicians. So anyways, Tiberius died like at the age of like 73 or something. He lived a long time too. But the rumor has it, and Seutonius says that it's a believable rumor, that he was ended up getting smothered to death by the boss of the Praetorian Guard, Sejanus. No, not Sejanus, some other guy. At the bequest of Caligula, because Caligula knew that he was going to be the next guy. Caligula was the son of Germanicus, who was, I think he was Tiberius's. No, he was. I don't know how it goes, but he was. He was like Augustus's brother's kid or something, but he was the last, and he wasn't that closely related to Tiberius, but he was the last remaining male relative in the royal family. So he was just the natural guy to pass it off. So he knew, so he had Tiberius killed. And he was a psycho boy too, because he grew up on Capri with Tiberius. And all of his own family members had either died, like with Germanicus, who was the great, the wonderful general. He was poisoned, but all of his other family members and extended family had been killed by Tiberius, and he'd seen him get killed. And Caligula was just like loving it. He was just as cruel as Tiberius and loved torturing people too. He was in his element. And Tiberius even mentioned, like, that boy is going to destroy, that boy is pure evil. He's going to destroy the whole empire. but Caligula managed to, what they said of Caligula was he was the greatest servant and the worst master. So he was totally obedient to Tiberius, did exactly what Tiberius told him to do. Went along with everything Tiberius totally, and probably because he loved torturing people too, and just learned all that stuff from Tiberius, and then he became king when he was like 26 years old, and when Caligula became emperor, like everybody rejoiced because everybody hated Tiberius and they were terrified of Tiberius because, you know, I think there had been other coups. Like, when Tiberius moved out to Capri, he basically left all the power to the Praetorian prefect, the leader of the Praetorians, which is like the army within Rome to protect Rome and Italy, named Sejanus. And in I, Claudius, that was portrayed by Patrick Stewart, captain of the Enterprise, who was bald in those days as well, in the 70s. But I guess Sejanus tried to have a coup and take over power from Tiberius, but ended up not being successful and getting killed by Tiberius, assassinated. And then it went back to the other Praetorian guy. So Tiberius died and everybody rejoiced and Caligula came in power. And so everybody was totally excited about Caligula being in power because they had remembered how wonderful his dad was. And Caligula, he was called, his real name was Gaius Julius Caesarus or something like that. But they called him Caligula because Caligula meant little boots and because he had been paraded around the camp of the army camp since he's a little kid with his dad up in like all over Europe and stuff, dressed in these little soldier boots and drilling the soldiers like a little kid, even though he didn't know what he was saying. All of the soldiers followed him and thought he was just the cutest guy. So everybody was really happy about him being the emperor because, you know, they had a 200 million sesterces surplus in the bank account, state coffers, and it was a brand new empire which was super wealthy. King rulers of the entire world, and they had just gotten rid of this bad emperor. By the way, Tiberius was the emperor when Jesus Christ was alive. When Jesus Christ said, you know, give unto Caesar who is Caesar's and give unto God what is God's, he's talking about Tiberius. Tiberius was in power from 14 AD up until 20 or something AD. And Tiberius's third year of reign was when John the Baptist started preaching. So John the Baptist started preaching in 15th year of reign. John the Baptist started preaching in Tiberius's 15th year of reign. So John the Baptist started preaching in like the year 30. So John the Baptist started preaching not so much before Jesus. Anyways, when Caligula took power, everybody was thrilled and they thought Caligula was going to be like one of these other like God kings, you know, like Augustus, only even better. Because people were still butthurt over what Augustus did as far as all the wars. Because when Augustus was Octavius, he was he had to do what he had to do to take care of business. You know, he had assassinated people and he was like ruled kind of with an iron fist and he had the civil wars with Mark Antony and stuff. So he kind of had some dirty hands, even though he was a brilliant, a genius and a great person. They thought that maybe Caligula would be even better and Caligula would be the now golden age. And so Caligula goes into power and the first thing he does is forgive all the people who Tiberius had like condemned to die and who had banished and let them all come back to Rome and you know claimed that he was going to give a new golden age to Rome and he was Caligula was a really good speaker. He was a really studious student of rhetoric and like elegance, so he could speak with a great vocabulary and great, affluence and the gestures and everything, put on a great show. And everybody was like, yay, Caligula. And I guess for the first like 6 months or something, he spent a whole lot of money, the money that they had on all of these like games, gladiatorial games. And like they slaughtered like, you know, 100,000 bears and lions and everything. And people loved him for that and made him even more popular, even though he's spending all their money. There's the populace. They don't know. They don't care. They just want to go to the party. And so he got even more popular and he partied so much that he almost died. He got really sick and almost died. And all these people, started like killing themselves so that he would live and setting out babies, newborn babies, to die as sacrifices to him. And one senator said that he would, if he survived, he would fight a gladiator for him. So when he got better, he actually he changed. He was different when he got better. Like his mind had changed and he was now evil. And he told that senator who said he would fight a gladiator, he made him do it. And the guy was like fighting and he's like, please let me go. He's like, no, you keep going. And finally let him stop fighting the gladiators. Anyways, Caligula, at one point, Caligula went crazy and started doing crazier and crazier things. And in the end, Caligula ended up being like the craziest motherfucker like ever. This guy was batshit crazy. Maybe I should, I'll finish I'll continue tomorrow. I've talked enough now. I'll continue tomorrow, and I'll start with Caligula, because that guy was a super character. Okay, peace out.